Should I do a Prime video? This guy, he's famous for doing his Twitch stuff, Twitch streaming. He'll do a live broadcast for like 8 hours, and then he makes it private, and then he chops the live stream into pieces that he then piecemeals out during the week until he does another 8 hour long live stream. And anyway, he talks about software. He's like me. He watches other people program and then criticizes them. I haven't done that. Not on this channel. On my old channel, I used to do that. Make fun of how people programmed back in the 2000s. And nowadays, I just go after people that say that they're role players, that they're group role plays, and when they say on Twitter, "Hey, we just posted our live actual play. Hope you enjoy it. We role played like forever. It was an amazing session." So I, of course,
you have my attention.
You know, I'm gonna go look at it. I'm gonna go watch your YouTube video of you guys playing, role playing for 4 hours. And then I get very disappointed when I see no roleplay of any kind in their game. I've been lied to. So then I have to post a video of me watching their video and pointing out where some excellent roleplay could have happened during their game. And they failed. They failed to do even that. Anyway, so this is Prime. He's a programmer. He has virtual setups where he fits himself in. He's a green screener. I've never mastered the green screen thing. He has, apparently.
Hey! Hey, yeah. Come over here. Yeah, come on, hey.
I've worked in a place like this. Human resources, the person's name is Karen. Oh my god. It's just one big room. Open office, sort of. It's got cubbies. It's got cubicles, sort of, in a way. You have two walls to your cubby. I've been in worse rooms. I've been in worse rooms where it's just one wall or two walls of your cubby. And the wall is only how high is this table? 29 inches? Yeah, the wall's only 4 feet high. 4 feet high. So the wall comes up to like here. When you're sitting down. And, everyone can like talk to each other. Everyone sees each other while they're working on their projects and stuff. This was, I was working for a satellite company that did, oh, what were those trucks? Those trucks in Africa? In Africa! Self-driving trucks that haul diamonds to and from mines. GPS nonsense. The cars, these trucks are like, what, 30 stories tall? If one tips over, it's kind of a big deal. But the satellites track where they all are, how fast they're moving, how much fuel they have. What is this on a weekend or on a weekday? Should they be in their cages? Has one gone through the fence? What's that called? There's like a some sort of fence. You set up in 3D space, and if a truck goes through it, it shuts off. Or not allowed to pass beyond a certain point. It's not a real fence, it's just a virtual fence. Anyway, so I was not debugging, I was, what do they call it? I was the, I'm the guy who finds the bugs. Everywhere I've been, I'm the guy that looks for bugs in software. It's what I do. And, of course, I'm working with dummy data. So sometimes the dummy data has bugs in it. So I try to get data that's going to work, you know, that's real data. And then work on code to see where the bugs are in the code, trying to decipher the data that it's reading. And there's three ways they can talk to these trucks, either with the satellite or with GSM. I don't know. That's a phone thing, I guess. And the, what was the other one? Satellite, GSM, and GPS. There was a GPS way to find it, too. So three ways you could talk to this thing. If I remember right. It's been a while. He's having fun. He's having fun in his little two-wall cubby.
Hey, I just wanted to take a second and tell you two things in my kind of long career that were the most foundational moments of my life in programming. And so the first one has to do with data structures and algorithms, and specifically two things. The first one was seeing how a stack was created, really a linked list was created.
I was going to say like a binary tree or a linked list, sorting depth first searches and stuff through a tree, you know, searching through a tree, linked list kind of thing. It's what we all had to do in the 80s.
Seeing a class in Java 1.5. Yes, I said 1.5. It was a while ago, okay? Just seeing how a class could have a value and another field that can reference the class that it was created in, and then being able to see how memory was laid out and all that just blew my mind so much, and I became so excited about programming. I still remember that was the moment in my programming career where I went from, I don't know if I like this, to I absolutely love this.
Okay, I went from, for me it was the if-then statement in BASIC. So that was like, okay, you can go if something equals, if something doesn't equal, if something's less than, if something's greater than. That was the point where I'm like, okay, you can actually do something on a computer. Okay, instead of just adding and subtracting, you got conditions you can compare. And then soon after that, I was like hacking into a Star Trek game, changing things. Normally the ifs were the limits of galaxies. You know, if you're beyond this point, you're out of the galaxy kind of a thing. So you just change those values in the if-then statements. And usually there would be a range of numbers. You change the ranges and you can do more things in the game. You can add more ships, more enemies. The controls back then were like if A was pressed, if B was pressed, if C was pressed, that kind of thing. This is basic. You know, 40-something years ago. So you just add more if-then statements. If this button was pressed, if that button was pressed, you just keep adding to the game what you can do in Star Trek. Because I wanted to beam down to planets and explore, so more if-then statements.
And then the second big one was recursion, like being able to understand recursion. I remember just taking so much time and like...
Come on, really? Recursion is a fun experiment, and then you do it once and it's like, oh, okay, that was neat. But have I used recursion ever in any of my programs? No.
Writing out factorial, right? The recursive way. Or doing summing the recursive way. Or doing the Fibonacci sequence the recursive way. Or even copying the Tower of Hanover.
Yeah, Fibonacci, that's like 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5. Is that how that goes? I guess. So he likes to do iterations. He's an iterations guy. I'll do iterations. Yeah, I do the Monte Carlo method, firing buckshot at a graph, and firing as many buckshot as I can in one shot to make the graph look more accurate. Because you're measuring the buckshot that's above the curve and below the curve, you know, that kind of thing.
Hanoi code, which was, I still don't even understand that to this day, but I remember none of those set in, and I thought, okay, I'm just not smart enough for computer science. I can't learn this. I don't understand recursion. And there was one problem specifically that we had to do for the same class that showed me linked list.
Yeah, every Pascal class, every C class, I don't think you could do this in basic. What was it? PL1? And APL is a language I never took. I never learned APL. ADA. What was the other one back then? Couldn't do it in Fortran. At least the Fortran we were using back then. Fortran 77. Fortran 80. What was another language we used back then? Oh, Java was just starting out. I never took any Java classes. I still don't know Java to this day. Don't need to. Everything's a class. I don't like class programs. I'm more of a procedural guy. I hardly ever use classes. Only when I have to. If it's something that you need to write classes, then I'll use classes. But if I don't need to use a class, I won't. If I don't need to do recursive, I won't. But yeah, every programming class, computer science class, not business computing class, but computer science class, you were always going to have that assignment. Chapter 4 of the book is going to talk about recursion. So you're going to write a program in recursion. It's just a thing. But do you use it in real life, though? I don't know. If you're doing chaos theory, probably. If you're doing fractals, yeah, you're probably going to do recursion. If you're doing chess, you know, you have the chess computer thing trying to solve the best move, that's recursion half the time. Because each square, it's looking at each square, right? And then it's backing up. It's backing up and recursing through what it just did. And then it's doing other things. That's how it's thinking of its best move to make. I wrote programs like the Knight's Tour. That's when you have a chessboard and one knight. You just have one knight piece. You start the knight anywhere on the board. Just pick a random square. And from that square, you move the knight to other squares until you have moved the knight to every single square on the board. It's like a puzzle game. So that was fun writing programs in different languages for different computers to just run through those little demos of the knight, you know, animated screen of the knight just moving around on a chessboard until it's filled in, until it's landed on every square. And you got to write the code right. Otherwise, the knight ends up painted in a corner where it moves into a square, and then it can't move anywhere else because it's already visited those squares before. So you end up with a knight stuck somewhere. And that's what the teachers are looking for. Did your knight get stuck, or can it solve everything, all the things?
Very different experience on LinkedIn. But it was a maze solving algorithm, and it was super simple.
Oh yeah, mazes. I did the mazes thing too. I was trying to do that stuff in the 70s before I even went to college and learned about recursive. I didn't know what recursive was till I was in college.
When once I saw how that worked, all of a sudden it was like, I see recursion. I know recursion. Like I just knew it. I knew.
Yeah, if you're gonna solve a maze, generate a maze, solve a maze, whatever. The oldest trick in the book was to just follow the wall on the right. Usually would get you through a maze. If you just stayed along the right wall. Just follow the right side and just, you know. That was the old school way of getting through a dungeon sometimes.
Knew it, and I knew I could do it awesome, and it was one of the best experiences of my lifetime. And so the reason why I say this part is...
But how many times do you ever have to do that, though? How many times do you have to do a maze algorithm for your company's software? When does that ever happen?
That for free on Front End Masters forever. No credit card required. Sign up. You get this. This is 11 hours. This took me effectively 200 hours to prepare. I get asked this question all the time. What is the free algorithms course that I mentioned? This is it right here. We go over lots of things, including tries, implementing a heap. We crush it. Depth first search, binary search, blah, 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 blah. All the good stuff, all the algorithms, all the things that made me a good programmer to this day.
Yeah, these are science, computer science things, algorithms. He called them algorithms. Before YouTube had algorithms, these were the algorithms. Scientific ones. And, I mean, they're interesting. I can't remember the last time I did a binary search. I can't remember. I mean, they're helpful. They're useful. If you have binary trees that you need to search. I don't have binary trees I need to search. I hate to say it, but there's already libraries that do that for you. You just point the software library at your data, and it does all the things for you. You don't have to... I mean, in the 80s, if you wanted the computer, your computer to do something at home, you had to write it. You had to write it yourself. In this day and age, you just go on the internet and download something that does it already. So you can focus on the other things you want to program. You know, some people like programming in assembler or C. You know, they like digging a hole with a spoon. That way you can keep track of every grain of sand if you're digging with a spoon. Now I'm brute force. You know, nuke it from orbit just to be sure. Then you have a hole. Then you have a decent sized hole to start with. I don't care where the sand went after the bomb. I don't care. But C programmers are really detail focused on memory, especially memory, memory use, memory mapping, searching through memory. Because if you think about it, the memory is your video. Back in the day, your video screen was memory. So you would tweak the memory. And whatever you tweaked would change on the screen. And you had to, you know, XORing and the ands and the ors, and you had the scroll side-scrolling games. That's all memory that you're just shifting so that the video pointer is pointing at a certain part of memory. And, yeah, you do that in either machine code or assembly or C. Not COBOL. Don't use COBOL. Yeah, if to me that's too. I like the more generics, not generic stuff. What is it called? High level? Is it super, is it high level? I don't do the low level stuff anymore because I don't have to. There's programs like Python now that take care of all that stuff, so I don't have to think about it. I can just get my program written.
Okay, we go over, and I just found it super important in my life, and so I wanted it to be super important in your life. And that's why I worked with Front End Masters. We made it free. I'm going to include a link down below. If you use the link and you do end up paying and buying a membership, then I get something, baby. That's right. We're talking about I get something then. But if you just watch it for free, I get nothing. Totally awesome. Go and do that. It is worth the time it takes because it will dramatically shape your career. And I do mean that. And so.
Yeah, he's one of the only guys that what's the word? What he says is what will happen. Some of these computer guys on YouTube, they're fake YouTube computer guys. Just like in D&D, there's a lot of fake D&D guys on YouTube. But this guy, he actually knows what he's talking about. Oh, 3D artist. Is that what it says? Yeah, I was in this magazine a few times back in the day when it used to be sold at Barnes & Noble. Anyway.
So that's, well, I don't know what happened. I breathed in, my like throat collapses, like the soft palate, my back, my throat. Blah, blah, blah. Anyways, yeah, this is all one take.
But yeah, what he talks about in his videos is what he did in real life to be a programmer. If you do the things in his video, you will be a programmer. You can't help but be a programmer if you do all the things. Some people, they say, go to my Udemy Academy, whatever, go there, go to DeVry, go to that mountain one. What was that mountain one called? Yeah, go there and get your degree online, blah, blah, blah. No, but if you do what he did, you can get a job pretty fairly quickly. If you want to be like a I'm a hobbyist. I do computer stuff as a hobby. I don't want to be a computer programmer in real life. I like writing software for myself. I don't like writing software for another company, if that makes sense. It's boring. We need you to write some software for us that will do this and this. I'm like, I'd rather not. I like writing software that's interesting to me. It's like, oh, we need an accounting system for our dentist office. No. No. And then every little bug, every little thing that happens, you're the guy they're gonna call for the rest of your life. You wrote us this thing for us a long time ago. Can you update it to the new Windows for us? You're forever their slave.
You get stream brain right now. And so the second one, and the second thing that was like probably the most important or second most important thing in my life was learning how a compiler works. This was just, I cannot.
Oh yeah, that's another kind of programmer. Someone who writes their own language. I know in college, I knew guys like that. They were writing their own languages. They were like, C's okay, but I'm going to use C to write my own language. That's what everyone was talking about in the 80s. That's what everyone did. Everyone did that in the 80s. I'll just use C to write my own computer language. I'm like, oh, okay. I didn't care much for C either, but I wasn't about to write my own computer language. I just waited. I waited until a better language came out. I didn't do programming for the longest time. I was happy with BASIC 09 on a Tandy Color Computer 3 running OS 9 Level 2. That was my go-to language. I thought things cannot get any better than this. This is what's best in life. And then Windows 95 came out, and I thought, okay, I'll give this Windows 95 thing a try. And I looked at the programming languages available for it, and it was like, this sucks. This sucks balls. But then something called Python came out, and it was like, oh! Python's my favorite language of all time. I wish Python was around in the 70s, but no. Even if you go back in time and try to get Python to do things on old computers, nope. Python requires a certain tech level for it to run on. The 70s wasn't it. But man, if Python could run on a computer from the 70s, oh man. Things would be so much different now.
cannot tell you the amount of different tasks I've had over the years, or learning new languages, or doing things that have made such a dramatic difference in my life, and I just understood how it works. And so, like, here's a quick example. I know, again, this is gonna sound crazy, but I had to used to do Groovy a bunch, right? And you'd get these errors. I could read the stack traces because I built something similar to create closures in a language that didn't have closures as part of my exercise building a compiler. And so, like, I understood what Groovy was doing underneath the hood in the JVM, and I could get it at a fundamental level where everyone else was just like, dude, what the hell's happening? They just didn't have the same experience I had. And I also could understand.
Yeah, I was one of those guys that could understand blue screens. When Microsoft Windows would do its blue screen of death, people are like, oh, my screen, my machine froze, it blue screened. And I'd say, well, what does it say? It doesn't just blue screen. Windows is telling you something. It's telling you what failed on the computer. But people would just not even understand that message. Me, I was able to understand those messages like it was nothing. And I could, once the machine would reboot, I could fix the problem and get rid of the blue screen errors. Most people, they were taking their computers to the computer store to get fixed. You know, getting it upgraded. The store would talk them into buying a new computer. They would say, oh, this computer's too old to be running here. Nah, you need a new computer. No, the blue screen actually had, like, basic information. At least to me. I'm trying to think when I last had a machine blue screen on me. A machine that I built, that I used at home. I want to say a Pentium 3. Probably like a 300 megahertz. How many? No, I had a 1 gigabyte. I had a 1 gigahertz Pentium 3. I think that's how fast they went back then. Or a 900 megahertz Pentium 3. And that thing blue screened once. And it was the stupid printer driver I was using at the time. All in one printer driver. So I chucked that, got a different printer. Worked. I wasn't about to wait for HP or whoever it was to update their printer driver. It was an old printer. But there was like a service, what do they call it? Service packs? Is that what they were called? Anyway, you install one of those, that would fix a blue screen if you're willing to wait a year.
And it, with JavaScript, the reason why I could understand JavaScript so quickly is because I got it. I understood what was happening because I've built something similar. Building a compiler will plus one your understanding of...
Oh yeah, machine code. If you learn machine code... If you learn how a CPU works and how memory works on your motherboard, this is all natural when you see the errors and stuff in computers. You just know what happened.
Any programming language, just like so much faster. It is just incredible what it does. And so that's why also, again, I know this is crazy. We've been building this on stream right here. You can use code theprimegen. You get 30% off. I get $0 from this one. I get nothing. This is not a sponsorship. This is not an ad. Thorsten Ball, amazing writer, makes an incredible book. It is literally 30% for you, 0% for me, 70% for Thorsten. He's a great guy, and he agreed that he would like to just help get people this out. I think this is super important. And you can also join in on all the fun on the repo right now. We're just trying to get this interpreter built in a whole bunch of different languages.
And Prime, he runs Linux on his computer. He doesn't do Windows. So if you ever ask him a Windows question in chat, he just looks at you like, I don't know this Windows thing. I don't know this Windows you speak of. He's a Linux guy. And he's a Rust guy. His programming language is Rust.
Which is, we actually got quite a few right now. I really need help managing this. The pull requests are coming in faster than I can do. Like, what the hell? Why do we got ChatGPT coming in here and actually, like, look at this. We're prompt engineering. He's prompt engineering. Anyway, so it's like, you know, building an interpreter or building a compiler will also just be something that will plus one your career so much. It makes
he's doing his video from his imaginary programming office that people hate working in. People hate programming in these kind of places. Like, you got two monitors, you got your tower computer here against the wall, and you got this clackety clackety keyboard, you know, from 30 years ago. Still works. And you just want to kill yourself. Look at this carpet. You just want to kill yourself working in a place like this. Ay, ay, ay. I worked in a place like this for, 20-something years? That was murder. Murder.
Such an incredible difference in how you look at a programming language if you understand how it works, not at just the surface level or you explaining to someone else who understands programming, but at the underneath the covers level. And so I just wanted to take the time and tell you the two most important things in my career that I can kind of look back on. There's a few other important ones. Maybe we'll go over those at another time, but I wanted to talk about those two just due to how important they were to me and the fact that I can even remember so many moments almost 15, 20 years later, like in the class I can remember. It's hard to describe how important it was to me. So I hopefully you like this. Hey, hit the sub button, hit the like button, do all those things you know you got to do. Because if you don't do that, then I'm sad. You want a Satigen? Is that what you want? The name? The Satigen. I gotta press the stop button because this is all one take.
Me too.